Okay, so for this section, this is a structure.
Okay, so hi guys. So for this session, is actually we tell you guys about what exactly global citizen is about and how it can be to actually help you to improve yourself as well as in your life. So yeah. So firstly, I would like to congratulate you guys on taking the first step out of the comfort zone by actually signing up for this program. And just want to say that it's really a once in a lifetime opportunity to actually be given the time to go for this program to see what is outside of Singapore, to actually see what like how the locals in other countries use as well as to actually make it. Okay, so maybe before I begin, can you guys like take a look under your seats? Yeah. See if there are any water bottles. So those who have bottles underneath your seat, can you all please come up? Yeah, just take the bottles out and come out. Which one do you think I actually bought from FairPrice? Thank you guys, so maybe you can go back and take a seat. Yeah, okay. So you all can tell by by buying these bottles from different places, actually cost very differently. But do you all think like the water actually tastes different? How many of you guys actually think the water tastes like different when you buy from different brands, different places? So like as you all can see, actually it does not make a difference where you get your water from. Like, because we are in a country like in Singapore, where actually water is something that you can easily get from our tap water. Where we are, even when we are bathing, we are using essentially clean water to bathe. So how does it compare to like, other countries? So like countries like India, countries like Egypt, people do not have like easy access to water. There's approximately like around 738 million of people who do not have clean access to water every day according to them. So you all think like do you all think we are actually very fortunate to be living in Singapore? Like even in places like Egypt, like it's like one in every four Egyptians actually spend more than 1 hour per day actually just to get like clean water. Okay, not say clean water, but to get access to water to bring back to their households every day. So this is like how it is to actually be in developing countries. And other than clean water, a lot of developing countries are also suffering from what you might say the lack of education. According to the Global Water Education survey that was done by UN, they actually found out that at least 215 million children worldwide are not able to read well, write well. So basically they have a very bad literacy rate. So do you think like by going on this global citizen program, you are able to change your lives? Okay, maybe I can share a show of hands. How many of you actually think we are able to change our lives just by going on this trip? So I think it's very apparent that all of you know that this trip will not be able to change much about the lives of these kids, of the situation in the world. But that's not the point that I want to make. So I think most of you have actually heard about voluntourism. So how many of you have actually heard of voluntourism? Like, you have heard of voluntourism? Voluntourism. Okay, so for those that have no idea about voluntourism is about, it's actually the idea of doing volunteering work while you are touring a foreign city, foreign country at the same time. So there is actually like things about voluntourism that actually makes it a very hot debate nowadays. So a lot of people are saying that voluntourism will not really allow you to change the world. Voluntourism is only it's an idea that will actually bring more harm than good. And for most of these points, it's actually valid in the sense that even by, like for example, we can take our global citizen program as an example. If you are going overseas for 6 to 8 weeks, do you think you will actually be able to keep them engaged to improve their literacy rate like by leaps and bounds, like from being unable to speak English to being able to speak fluent English, to be able to communicate in fluent English within the top 10 of the grade? How many of you actually believe that? So how many of you actually believe that we are able to improve lives, like for example during our social entrepreneurship project, we are able to improve the lives of people living in rural villages, improve the lives of people living in rural parts of the country just by being there and sharing with their ideas? How many of you believe that by sharing your ideas, by actually initiating conversations with them and getting to know them, you'll be able to change their lives? So maybe I can show you guys like next video. We'll show you guys a video to actually understand more about how global citizen actually aims to change the world. And that is what we as AIESEC believe in our program.
There are lots of ideas how you can change the world. Some people think you should just complain about it. I won't change the world, I'll just make it bad. Some people think you have lots of money on it. Make it rain everywhere you go. However, for a dollar, some people think you have to be really loud and yell a lot. So I put the bullhorn shouting.
Hey, you! Yeah, you! Do it my way right now! You heard?
Other people choose to just make fun of everything. That's dumb, everyone's dumb. It's easier to make fun of stuff, but it's cooler to make stuff. Some people think changing the world can only be done by the smartest person in the world. Just come in the room, let them figure it out. The solution of world hunger? Food. Wow, that was like so amazing. Some people see the bad in the world and they just decide to ignore it. But that won't help anything. Some people think you have to be really famous to be cool. In fact, lots of people think you have to be really powerful to make a difference. Like being mayor, or senator, or president. But the truth is, a title doesn't make you more important. The world is changed by you. If one person filled with love, and they just have to live it out, so they do something awesome. Then that person is filled with love, and they do something awesome. It just goes on and on. And the next thing you know, everything's awesome. Some people think it's impossible to change the world.
It's impossible to change the world.
Well, you can see why they can think that. Living in a world with kids who are hungry, people who are homeless, families who are happy. I'm just trying to figure it out like everybody else, man. I do know this though. Next time you feel overwhelmed or totally alone, remember this. Things don't have to be the way they are. The world is changed by ordinary people. Little people living out big world. And that's what gives the world a reason to dance.
So how many of you actually managed to capture the essence of this video? Okay, maybe we have Lydia to share like what's the essence of this video.
Okay.
Media and key president actually put it, it's not actually about like complaining, it's not about having power to do something. It's actually the ability to touch lives. So that is actually what our Global Citizen Program gives you. By being able to go on a trip to actually like places like Taiwan, places like China, you actually are able to actually get in contact with, let's say, the host family, with kids in rural villages. You can also be given an opportunity to get in touch with like other youths that are like delinquent youths or maybe youths that actually suffer from low literacy rates. So these are people that you actually be interacting with a lot during your project. So how do you actually try to change them? It's not about how much you can teach them within the short span of 6 to 8 weeks. In this program, it's actually about how much you can actually touch them, how much you can inspire them. Like for example, in education projects, it is not about how much you can like teach them, how many ABC characters you can teach them, how many alphabets, how much grammar you can teach them. It's about getting them interested and getting them inspired in learning this language. So actually, it's about how you touch their lives with your passion. And that is what our program is about. Something special about our program is that other than being able to touch lives, other than being able to actually inspire other people, which is actually about your ability to empower others, this program actually allows you to get local support from other AIESECers that are in the city to actually, like for example, bring you around the cities, or if you have any cultural questions or any cultural uncertainties and inability to fit in, you can actually get some help from them. And at the same time, be able to like explore the world, be able to explore the city, being able to interact with other cultural exchange participants as well, making you a world citizen. During our Global Citizen program as well, you'll also be able to like, I mean, when you are traveling abroad, how many of you have actually tried traveling abroad before? Maybe I can have a show of hands, how many of you actually tried traveling abroad before? Alone? Okay, so maybe you can take 1 minute to share about like, what are the problems that you have met when you were traveling abroad. Do you have any comments? Thank you. So like it's very apparent like when you actually travel abroad on your own, you also meet like a lot of new challenges, a lot of uncertainties. And these are actually things that will actually help you to grow. These uncertainties will actually make you to be, mold you to be solution-oriented people. And that is something that our program wants to encourage as well. And lastly, during this trip, you'll be able to have a lot of time for self-reflection, as well as like being exposed to a lot of new interests, a lot of new activities. And this will actually allow you to actually discover yourself. This will allow you to have a better self-understanding of what you want in your life. So that is what our program can actually do for you. So I hope you guys like understand our program better after this short session. And if you are actually interested, very interested to go for this trip like during this winter or maybe even next summer, then this is the part where you need to look out for. So this is where my friend Xingyi is going to talk about like the Global Citizen process, how we actually help you to get matched to your project, and what help can we actually offer during this program. So can I invite Xingyi back to
Hi guys, now I'm actually going to like the general application for Global Citizen program. So this is actually quite important now, so you might want to take all this, but then like the other day we'll keep sending these slides. Okay, before I go into the details, I'll just start off with a video so that you guys have like a general idea of what the application flow is like.
You're here because you've probably heard about an organization called AIESEC, and they tell you that they can offer you internships, volunteer, as well as leadership opportunities all over the world. And you wonder how this can be. Well, let me tell you in 4 easy steps along with my journey. Step 1, connect. I found out about AIESEC through a friend who helped connect me to more people in AIESEC, and that's really where this all began. Step 2, search. Like me, you'll be paired up with a manager who will help you step by step through the whole process. With her instructions, I set out for my search, but being the picky person I was, my search turned into days, which then turned into weeks, and then turned into months. And there it was. Step 3, match. I was referred by a friend to a project in a country called Montenegro. So I sent them my application, and a few hours after that, they asked for my CV. And a few hours after that, I got called in for a Skype interview. Halfway through that interview, I got the job. It may not have been a well-known country. In fact, I've never heard of it before. But after a few searches, it was perfect. A perfect opportunity for a new experience. Step 4, go. With my passport and ticket in hand, I finally embarked on a 3-day journey and landed in Podgorica, Montenegro, where I was then welcomed by 4 members with smiling faces and open arms to this new adventure. So here's my average work day. Every day I wake up to go to...
So yeah, that's the general
idea
of the application flow that you can expect. Like if you're still unsure of the flow or whatsoever, right? Not to do like through our recruitment rules, through our intro talk and all that. And since like all of you are here, right, you all have like the influence that now. Okay, second step is actually search. Like as a global citizen participant, right, you guys have to actually like search for your own project and apply for your own projects. And you can actually do so through this portal with one expert. This on XPA, right, there will actually be like a lot of projects for you all to choose from and apply for. So like we'll be teaching you how to like just kind of on the XPA later on. Okay, next is the team manager. Like each of you here will actually be tagged to the team manager. It will be like facilitating you throughout the application process. Basically, your team manager is like the point of contact. Like you can. If you face any question or difficulties in your application or whatsoever, right, you can just like approach the EP manager. I'm sure there will be like more than willing to help you. Yeah, basically the EP manager is us, like. Okay, third step is match. So after you found your desired projects on XPA and after you have been tagged with like EP manager, you can actually start applying. And after you start applying, right, the project manager from host IP to actually contact you and arrange for the Skype interview. Oh yeah, so like during the interview, right, you actually have to like take note of a few things, right, now going through those important things. Right? Okay, firstly, the most important thing is like accommodation. Basically for the DC program, right, there's two main types of accommodation. One being like homestay and the other being hostel. For homestay, it's usually like free of charge, so you don't have to worry about that. But then for hostel, you actually have to pay like extra fee for it. So you need to check with the project manager really, like what kind of accommodation you actually like providing you. Then secondly, it's meals. Because sometimes meals will be provided, like for example, in your workplace or the whole family might actually like provide meals for you. But then in other cases, you actually have to purchase the meal. So you just check with the project manager, like, is like our meals provided. Okay, next, you need to check the duration of your global student program. Usually, our programs last for around 6 weeks. But you realize that you go for the full 6 weeks, right? You actually miss 1 week of school because you eat in the academic term next year. So in such cases, you might want to like negotiate with your project manager during the interview. But then you want to shuffle it to like 5 weeks so that you can start your school on time. But then in other cases, you can just like go for the full 6 weeks and then you just like install it on school. Right? Okay, this is quite important, visa requirements. Before you go, right, you have to like ask what are the requirements or requirements. Because for some countries, if you don't apply for visa, you might be considered like an illegal immigrant there. So yeah, you have to clarify to the project manager what are the visa requirements required. And sometimes the visa requirements application might take very long. For countries like Spain, Brazil, right, the application process is very long and it's very complicated, which is difficult a lot for students and all. So you have to like ask the project manager what are the documents required when you apply for a visa. And usually visa you can apply in Singapore before you go. But in some cases, right, you can only like apply for visa upon arrival. So you might need to prepare some documents beforehand and you have to just like clarify the project manager in the view, like what are the documents that are required for you so that you can prepare like more beforehand. Okay, and we need to ask about like the arrival pickup. We have to clarify if there's anyone there who's going to pick you up from the airport when you reach that time. In most cases, the project manager or EP buddy will be the ones that pick you up from the airport. But it would be good for you to like really clarify, like to check if there's someone there to pick you up because you want to be like definitely. Okay, the interview is actually a pretty good platform for you to like clarify any doubts you have regarding the job description. So if you're unsure of the job scope, job responsibilities, right, you just like take this chance to clarify the project manager, like what are you supposed to do when you're there. Okay, next is AIESEC engagement. Usually when you reach your host country, right, you actually have to participate in some engagement programs to help you like integrate with the community there. So usually we'll call these programs like Global Village. And you might call ETs from all over the world to come together and participate in some cultural sharing kind of things. So you might need to prepare some traditional items from your home lab. So you need to ask the project manager, like, is there anything that you should prepare for? Is there such a program that you have to participate in so that you can prepare the items you bring to the job? Okay, so when you go to your home country, your host country, right, you'll be tagged with an ET buddy and project manager. Basically, these are the 10 people who will be like taking care of you in that country. So during the interview, you might want to ask for their contact numbers if possible. Okay, next is transportation. You need to ask what kind of transportation is available in the country. And like what's the estimated transportation cost, like the bus fare, etc. Because like I don't think transportation is provided from your home state to your workplace. So you might need to fork out your own transport costs. So it'd be good to clarify like how much you have to prepare for transportation. Okay, next is Wi-Fi. So like Wi-Fi is very important for you guys, right? Because like a foreign country, you need Wi-Fi to contact your family back home. Then you also need Wi-Fi to like, you know, update your social media platform and all that to your experience. Yeah, so you need to check like, whether they provide Wi-Fi to your family. Okay, so like basically those are the things that you have to take note of in going through the interview. But like what if you're not met? What if like you happen to not pass the interview? You actually like have to go through the entire process all over again. You have to like search for a project all over again and go through another interview all over again. So actually we encourage you guys to apply for up to 5 to 10 projects so that if you're rejected from one project, you have another project to apply that. Okay, so in cases where you are matched, right, you actually have to sign an exchange participant acceptance note. But okay, let's say you apply for 3 projects and all 3 projects accept you. You can only accept only 1 acceptance note and you have to reject the other thing. But there will be no penalty like if you reject everything. Okay, so once you sign the acceptance note, right, you'll be officially matched. And you can prevent it. Okay, so before you go, you have to apply for visa, like what I mentioned just now. And you have to get insurance also. This is very important, travel insurance. You know, like one of my friends, not like she, like when she went for a program there, exchange program there, she actually like lost some money, and her insurance was actually able to cover like part of the loss. So it's actually very handy. I don't underestimate like the importance of insurance. And we have actually partnered with Prudential, and we have some insurance plans which is very suitable for our global citizen program. So we'll be recommending those insurance plans to you guys. And if you happen to be going to your global citizen program this winter, right, there'll be an outgoing preparation seminar on 7 November. And some of our insurance partners will be coming down to promote their insurance plan so you can purchase your plans there. So after you're done with all these, you can just let know. Do you have any questions regarding this now? Okay. So if no questions, I'll just go on to teach you how to apply on ESPA, like the account I'm talking about just now. Okay, so what is ESPA? ESPA is basically the acronym of Experience Isaac, and it's a portal for you to find and apply for all your exchange programs. Okay, so to create an account, right, you have to log on to internships.isec.org and register as a new user. And then you just like follow the instructions, fill in all your personal particulars, and eventually you'll be taken to the homepage. Yeah, I'll just log into my account and show you what this. Okay, so basically this is the home page of the account. And after you go through the registration process, like they ask you to fill in some particulars and all that, right? You still have to continue like filling in your particulars. Yeah, you have to make sure that you fill everything, like personal details, contact, academic experience, professional experience, like really feel every single thing, don't miss anything. But if you miss out something, right, you won't be able to apply for any reasons. So after you finish applying, like giving up all your personal details, right? And after you are tagged to a DC manager, okay, basically you will be tagged to a DC manager applying it. So yeah, after you fill out all these and after you have a DC manager assigned to you, you can actually start applying. And go back to the home page and start applying for project work, volunteer experience. You can actually like use all these features like at the right hand corner to help you like in your search for projects. Let's say you're interested in entrepreneurship, you can just click on this. And you can just click on your design interest. And you can even filter out your like duration, like when you want to go and when you want to come back. Yeah, and then all these projects will appear. You guys see like good things. So just click to do it. Read out all the descriptions, the job description. So if you're interested in this project, right, you can just click on sign out. And your project manager will then contact you and arrange a site for you to get. So this, so yeah. Okay, so that's all. I'll be passing back the time to Shi Yue, so we'll be giving you a presentation.
Thank you.
So after this, I have to look at all the efforts and understanding about how and how to use the website to apply and search for the projects. So, I know it's been a bit overwhelming, but if you still have any errors, feel free to contact your team manager or us. We'll always get you through the application process. So, okay, so next it will be the sharing section. There will be four past experience participants who are going to share about their own experience. So set into your groups, and after each group will be assigned to one ASP, and they will share after they share about their story, and they will proceed and go to the next group. So by the end of the session, each and every one of you will share about the four stories. So may I invite all the ASP to go to the guys, remember you're starting with the code group, right? And so, please move on now. So, next, for a short introduction of the session. So, hi guys, I'm Yu Wei. So actually, I went to Taiwan 2 years ago for internship.
My name is Scott, and I from just this summer to the upcoming industry.
So hi guys, I'm Harris again. So I actually went to, for those of you might know, because you were at the InfoTalk, but for those that were not at the InfoTalk, I actually went to Taiwan last winter for an education project. So it's somewhat similar to what you were doing.
That was
if you guys remember your group, do you mind just moving so that group one comes to the side? Group one?
Can I get like a feeling of how many people actually went to listen for my info talk when I was sharing? So the two of you have never heard my story before. Okay, so maybe for their sake, I'll just share the story again. Then if you've got any questions or anything, maybe wait until like, I share with my story and actually ask me. So maybe you guys can introduce yourselves first, like what are your names so that it'll be easier for us.
My name is Ray, I'm currently studying in Induction here.
Not
another
one.
So just to, okay, so basically like for my trip, I'll just start from like when I applied for it. So actually to maybe answer some of the questions that you might be thinking about, I actually started applying for my project on I think first it was winter, so it was around this period as well, which was around I started applying mid-October. And I got matched to my project actually by the end of October. So the whole process actually like spent between 2 weeks. So what I did was actually send in the application for the project. Actually, the project manager sent an email back to me. Then after that, like, we went for a site interview. And after that, they actually told me that they will give me the results like, in a few days time. And after that, they actually made me. So after matching for my project, I was like very excited to go for this program because like, I have never been to Canada before and this is my first time traveling abroad alone. Okay. So then, After that, it was actually my outgoing preparation seminar. So during the seminar, actually, I got prepared about what I should actually do during the project. What should I present about Singapore? I started brainstorming about what was so unique about our country, Singapore. And maybe for you guys, you all can brainstorm about what is unique about your own country as well. But the sharing might not be just restricted to Singapore. It's also about Singapore. Yeah. So I discovered a lot of things that I didn't know about Singapore lah. Like that is a story, that's another story that I'll share. When I went, my project actually started on the 1st of November. So luckily for me, my exams actually ended on 31st November. So I actually flew off right immediately after my exams ended. The day after. Yeah, when I went there, I actually met with the what's that called? The AIESEC NUS over there, who was supposed to be one of the exchange participants. So like during your trip, you will also be able to meet like such exchange participants by this. So these are people that will actually like let you know more about like the culture there, what you can expect from the project. So this is the time where you actually must really like just spend them all the questions that you have. So like because after that it will be very difficult for you to meet up with them because like the country is actually quite big and they are most of them will be having like their finals and everything during the general period as well. So they'll be also quite busy. But of course rest assured they'll always reply your mails and stuff like that. Yep. Then after that actually I went for my project. It's actually in a rural village called Ufong in Taiwan. So I went to Taiwan Taichung for my project. So during the project, actually, during the first day, I was like introduced to the kids, and I think the kids were all very excited to see like because they had never seen a person not from Taiwan before, like they had never seen a foreigner before lah in a sense, and they were like very excited to have foreigner to come to actually like teach them about like education to actually get to interact with them. Then during this project, I actually went to teach them about like a lot of different cultural stuff. A lot of like, for example, what you can find in Singapore, what are the food, what our culture is like, what is the different races. So it's a lot about like the cultural differences, educational differences. And I realized like in Taiwan actually, their education, like a lot of kids actually are fortunate to have education. So it's not like what you actually imagine. Because I think Taiwan is considered a rather developing country. In that sense. So a lot of kids actually nowadays they have the opportunity to study, but they are actually treating it like in Singapore how we treat education. So it's like they don't believe in the power of education. They just like think that oh I have to go to school, I have to do this, I have to do that, it's such a chore. And that is then I realized that something was wrong with their attitude, and they also was holding them back from actually learning like for example learning English. So basically like in school what they were doing was because in Taiwan their curriculum is very different. So other than actually having like those subjects to learn from, they actually have like after every 30 minutes of teaching, they actually have 15 minutes of like daytime. So what they will do is like they will play like Maduro, they will go to learn their own piano, they will learn to dance. So they have like a lot of activities lined up for them. So in a sense, this sort of became the highlight of like their education in Taiwan and not about like, learning. So that was something that I actually found was quite interesting. And at the same time, like this might mean that the students actually do not get to, if they are not proactive, they do not get to learn much from school as well. So that was the first thought that I actually had in my head. And actually, I went to like, discuss with like, the principal and the teachers on how I could actually make my lesson plan in such a way as to actually ignite that passion in them, to make them more interested in like learning English. So actually, like I found out, like the best way you can do this is actually through like creating games, creating quizzes for them. And like, I think in a sense, it's something that is similar to Singapore, what we do. Like a lot of teachers like they give us quizzes just to see like how is our progress in our studies. And like, I think that is something that actually works very well for such education projects. Like, they actually give them quizzes to give them games to get. And like some of them will have like started asking me like I tried this out for the first week. Then after the first I tried this out on the second week, sorry. So after the second week they actually came to me and started asking me like what quizzes was I thinking of for the third week, for the fourth week, and what are the like questions that I might actually give them so they can actually start to plan for them. So that was something that actually worked in the sense that they actually were very interested to actually win these quizzes in these games. Because like, I also brought along like Singapore freebies to give them. So I think like, that was something that actually I realized that to make the kids interested in the language as well. Then like something that I actually realized from this whole thing is actually like through this you'll be able to actually interact more with the kids, like engage them during the lessons. And I think most importantly, this is when you actually get to put in stuff like videos, put in stuff like practice sessions for them to actually improve their mastery, proficiency of the language as well. So something that actually made me quite happy after the trip was that I learned that some of the students actually went for a speech competition, like an English speaking competition, and actually managed to win some medals back. So I think that was something that actually made me very satisfied with what I actually did during my education. So that was the part about education. Then there is actually like a part on this global school trip where you can actually like learn stuff. Where you actually can get to do stuff differently from like what you have been doing. So I actually took this chance when I was abroad to actually like sort of learn cooking. So I think those that were am I sharing the other time actually like you guys might remember I cooked some Singaporean food. I made some Singaporean food to share with the kids. To share with the kids at the school as well. So like I have never tried cooking before in my life. So like actually the whole thing came about in such a way that actually while I was showing my like Singapore culture, showing them like how awesome the food is in Singapore, what are the different kind of foods they can find. Because I think Singapore is it's a very amazing kind of place where you can find a lot of different foods of different cultures. And that was something that I actually wanted to bring up to them during our discussion about cultural sharing. So like after the session, actually the kids were very interested to actually like know how the food tastes like and not just to hear me talking about like how excellent, how wonderful, how delicious the food is. So I think that was something that like the teachers also wanted to try out because they had never tried like Southeast Asian food in a sense. I think Taiwan food is very special. It's just that category, Taiwan food. So they had never really tried like other Southeast Asian food, like for example rojak, things like bak kut teh. So I think I took this chance to actually try to pick up some culinary skills overseas. And it was a very interesting experience because like actually through the whole episode, I actually got to interact more with like, people like the cooks, people like even the security guard in the school. Because I needed a lot of help to actually like find the ingredients that I needed to prepare this stuff according to, because you know like when you get these recipes from like the internet, all the ingredients will be like Singapore, you will be able to find in Singapore. But then we are not in Singapore. So that was the problem that I was using. So I had to like ask them what kind of ingredients. Okay. So maybe like what kind of like ingredients I can get and stuff like that. So it was like something that I learned like how to manage like sudden obstacles, how to like learn something. It was a very fun experience, I would say, like having to come up with food on your own. Then other than that, I think one thing from my whole global citizen experience is that I also got to know a lot of like from all over the world, because like I took part in the AIESEC program. I actually got to meet like a lot of friends from a lot of friends from Australia as well. So like I actually got to talk to them, and actually like I think until now we are still conversing with them. So like that is something that maybe you get to take out of our global citizen program. So like, do you have any questions for me? This was a partnership program. There were other Singaporean people as well. But it's a chance to actually interact with foreigners. So I actually tried not to like stick to the Singapore group. So like if you have anything, just feel free to ask any one of us. Yeah.
So your group is it?
Okay, so actually it's quite difficult for you guys to get results in Taiwan. Yeah, you don't even find it. That was the issue. Yeah. Because I think we have tried we have a lot of PRCs trying to apply for Taiwan. But it hasn't really worked out. English is the national language in Philippines. So you will be able to conversation.
So basically, what I do there is like,
most cases,
because the trend is like when they go there, they realize that the trend is entrepreneurship. And the youth there is like very rising. It's like everyone that open their own business, but they don't know how to operate. So, like we have a lot of teachers, like they're 16 years old students, they're very interested in like rock, metal and things. So they actually opened a program of like t-shirt printing,
hats,
printing, and shoes drawing and all to express their rock, metal and things. So they start from high school and now they are still learning, but it's just a very small business. It's not really big, so they want to expand. So actually our job there is to help them develop strategies for them to expand their business to different regions in Malaysia. And some of the enterprise there, which is like already need a big
one to expand for other people.
So in the countries there's only like no region at all.
So the first thing they want to ask you when you go there is like, what's your reason? The first thing, after asking your reason, what's your reason? That's it. Because in Malaysia, it's like,
you know, it's my
time change. I felt it's like Singapore.
So, like, a lot of people get like, eight dishes, ten course dishes, welcome me to their house. Oh my god, so my dishes, how am I supposed to
temples, they have some easy
model. And yeah, I think, I helped like essentially let them know about like what
So we actually got a lot of different solutions.
And within the person, we realized that he just can't go for it. So
yeah,
he just laughed.
So it's and it's the thing is, during that time, I went.
I know social enterprise was
Ramadan.
Good for
so basically, the thing is, the whole demand is they are first past the whole day from what's the time to like saying, like, it's like a good and bad.
So we saw
after the high of the day, we tried to the first time that we take
coffee or that for the
then,
so we managed to make 50 bags.
We tried to sell it and we took none of them.
Each of us stopped one bag and then I bought two stores. Then the rest was really awesome. And they were very, very nice. It was one very interesting thing I learned about students. You know what?
You
never sell
to
start like any queries,
like we lost our one for the second one,
so we cannot sell the
anything then after the office, we actually
but for this, it's a, I would say it's a bit expensive, but like, compared with
which is quite similar,
like, of other sellers from people that are
similar. But then some people that are similar,
but yeah, just
go to China on my mind. When I go there, I feel like,
so in the field, price
is from itself, like it's very, like you want to try out,
because in Malaysia, every 1 year, 5 weeks,
So it's only $1 only for two of them.
Then transfer from price, they spend less than $1.
As long as you are still on the same one, but if you take on the so on the time, it can be
what is that?
Oh,
three host families may be provided if at least one person in the family is affected. But this project is, and the application is ending soon, so if you are interested in the school project, maybe you can post it later like that. The next project is called Game Project in Cambodia. It's an educational project where you can work with like educational institutions and NGOs to be part of like designing their curriculum to help to educate the youth in Cambodia and empower them. You'll be taking part in a project orientation when you first reach there to get to know like the international students in the project together with you. And get to know the program better. You'll be going for like to explore the beautiful sceneries in Cambodia, and you'll be also taking part in the local village. And for accommodation, the local community is sourced for either hostel stays or home stays, but you don't have to pay for it, but it has to be $250. No, for the not a month, for the whole trip. Okay, the next project is called Global Transport in Kamar, Vietnam. One of our classes is Kamar, Vietnam. Okay, so I'll cover the for it. And, yeah, it's basically to empower the youth in Vietnam because they kind of lack in English communication skills and soft skills. So you'll come up with design and come up with an English communication course for them to develop their English communication skills like presentation, as well as soft skills and multicultural understanding. So we'll be also exploring Vietnam. To like see the sisters, and you'll be hostel or host families in Thailand. Next one is Philippines projects. They are actually the like more popular ones in the, among our current students. First project is NACASI, which is an education project to impact the life of underprivileged children through communication of basic skills. There's the Greek project, which is an environment project where you'll be trained on like urban farming, nutrition and waste management skills, and you'll be teaching these skills to the locals there to enable them to be more self-sufficient, like maybe farming in their own land. And there's this essential project, which is the social entrepreneurship project. So training will be provided each week to teach you about like the local business environment and like empower you, equip you with more like business knowledge, and you'll be imparting this knowledge to the local shops, like the micro entrepreneurs there, to help them manage their shops and come up with like maybe marketing plans and execute them. Taiwan project, sorry. Okay, these are two Taiwan projects that we have. They're both education projects. There's this one learning project, which is a juvenile detention project. You'll be working in a juvenile detention house in the morning, where you'll design and deliver sessions to help the people there to explore their career options and like through like cultural sharing, and at night you accompany children in interest groups for like kids children with higher risk to criminal conduct. So accommodation is $250, and this illuminated project is to visit cancer children where you can like talk to them and read them like English books to teach them English, and they will be going for art classes and make their own English, and will be holding their own like presentations. So you can be the one that's like help them to communicate their ideas to others with English. And accommodation is also priced at $250. That's some of our partnership projects, and if you are interested to find out more, you can continue with them.
Thank you. one, so we start a contact group by group, so one in law over there.
Sorry, just now those who paid the outside booth, can you like come over first so I can pass you back your phones? Because one is supposedly one you keep it and one you keep it. Yeah, there's six of you. Can you just come forward first?
And like the rest of
Thank you.